Look at that. That is fantastic.
With such an amazing coastline, it's no surprise that many of us fantasize about living in a wonderful home by the sea.
We've got salt water in our veins. Us Brits just love being by the sea. We're drawn to it, as if by instinct. And you can't help falling in love with the sights, the sounds, the smells. It's magical.
I'm architectural designer Charlie Luxton, and in this series, I'll get a unique view of some of Britain's most fantastic coastal properties. I'll design fantasy houses in some incredible seaside locations.
I think this would be a pretty amazing place to build a fantasy house.
And meet the people who've realised that ambition to have a home by the sea.
Here we are.
Wow, look at this. Having it framed like that, that is stunning.
On a rough day, you get the spray coming up.
Like Captain Ahab.
In this programme, I'm in the northeast of England, discovering what modern life is like on the ancient battle-scarred coast of Northumberland. Here, medieval fortresses are family homes. Seaside semis mask spacious interiors. And bedroom balconies open up onto spectacular scenery.
Wow, look at that view.
With miles of wide, deserted sandy beaches and a rich abundance of wildlife, this stretch of Britain's North Sea coast is a diverse and beautiful natural environment.
On a day like today, the Northumberland coast is as calm, tranquil and peaceful as it gets. But this is a county with a very troubled past. And you can see that in much of the area's architecture.
Northumberland is a place where the castle is king. There's more here than any other county in Britain. And they were essential to survive assaults from Viking raiders or skirmishing Scots. This craggy coastline was certainly once a brutal and often lawless place to call home. Taking me ashore on my own coastal invasion of Northumberland is a traditional cobble, a fishing boat unique to the northeast.
And my exploration of this magnificent bit of coastline begins here, in the fishing harbour of Craster.
Located 40 miles north of the city of Newcastle, Craster's a small village with a big reputation.
It's a place famous for that most traditional of British breakfast dishes, the kipper.
And the aroma of oak-smoked herring wafting from the smokehouses has lured in many a hungry, windswept traveller. This can be a harsh, unforgiving coastline that has always demanded the hardiest of building materials.
Northumberland is really well known for its sandstone buildings, but here in Craster, they build from this. This is called windstone. Now, the difficulty of building with this stone is that it's very, very hard, and when it comes out of the ground, it comes out in irregular shapes. Hard to work, but when you get it right, the colour and the texture are fantastic.
The harbour once shipped the locally quarried whinstone around the country. The curbstones of pre-war London are made from this resilient material.
I'm here in Craster specifically to visit a house that has an architectural history as muddled and irregular as some of this stonework.
Get a bonus digital prepaid MasterCard up to $400 on selected kitchen appliances at Bingley.
On a hillside overlooking the town is Craster Tower, the ancestral seat of the Craster family. First impressions are that this is a country house similar to countless others. However, look closely and you'll discover it's a home that has been evolving for nearly a millennia. It's part medieval watchtower, part Georgian manor house, showing me around a Victoria and Henry, who are the latest members of the Craster family to call this remarkable place home.
Victoria, your family has an incredibly long connection with this place, hasn't it?
It has, yes. It's nearly 900 years now.
900 years?
Yeah.
Give or take a few half millennia here
yes.
and there.
Yeah, it's a bit of an honour, actually. It's a bit of an honour to have lived here all that time, the same family in the house.
It's quite a weight of history, isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, my father at the moment is the last Craster of Craster. You used to be able to write letters and just put Craster, Craster, England, and they would get you.
They'd get you. Yeah, I can't do that. I'd quite like to be able to do that, but I can't do that.
The oldest remaining part of the home is this 14th century stone peel tower. Its name is derived from the Old English for enclosure. With their battlements and thick walls, it's clear to see why these buildings earned their nickname as poor man's castles.
So that's the Peel Tower, right? Now, they're sort of a defensive structure, aren't they?
That's exactly what they are, and they're dotted all over Northumberland and indeed into the Scottish borders and Cumbria as well. Because this part of England used to be a bit like the Wild West. There's a lot of cattle rustling, house burning, all that kind of raiding and pillage and all that stuff going on. So in your Peel Tower, you'd have the ground floor, which is where you'd put all your stores and supplies, the odd animal and that sort of thing. And then you'd have a wooden staircase on the outside up to the first floor, and that would be easily removable. You could chop that away and shut the door and lock yourself in. And then that would give you the
Hole
door
in
into
there
the
while they
Peel Tower.
Went exactly. around the outside and
yeah.
cleared off.
As border disputes diminished, Craster Tower was given aesthetic rather than defensive extensions. The east wing was added in the mid-1600s, before this Georgian facade was completed in the 1760s.
This is an absolute typical thing to do, isn't it? The Georgians, they love tidying everything up. Whack a nice-looking front and off you go. All your friends think you're very posh when they pull up.
But it's tucked around the side that you can see how this architectural jigsaw puzzle of a home fits together.
This is really the kind of seam, the zipper, that joins the three elements of the house together. So the old east wing, the peel tower at the back, and then the Georgian front here. But you can see all the utilities and
bits
and bobs.
Well, it's sort of perfunctory, isn't it? I imagine it works, but it's not going to win any awards, that little bit there, is it?
Yeah.
I came to see one house. I found three. It feels like I'm peeling back century upon century of design. This country pile has an incredible 14 bedrooms, 4 kitchens, and 9 bathrooms. I can't wait to see what it's like inside.
Welcome to Craster Tower.
This is pretty grand, isn't it?
So this is the Georgian stair?
Absolutely.
Wow, it's beautiful.
So are these all the relatives here down the hallway?
Some of them, yes.
Wow, look at them all.
In the Peel Tower is this stunning drawing room that was Gothicised around 1785. These huge windows and internal embrasures with their decorative arches and pillars were also added in keeping with the Georgian fashion of the day. But it's the lower section of the tower where you're truly transported back to another time.
Wow. This is quite some room, isn't it?
It is.
So what would this originally have been?
This originally would have been the place where all the provisions and stores were kept, out of reach of anyone with marauding intentions. Exactly that.
With its low vaulted ceiling and stone floor, you can feel the history of this room.
Your mob have been knocking around in this room on these stones for sort of 900 years.
Yeah, and it's quite weird to see. And when you see how uneven it is, don't break your ankle. You can believe it.
Now this most ancient part of the house is used to bring the latest generations of the Craster family together.
If we're more than 10, we eat in here.
So high days and holidays, you're in here.
Big families, Sunday lunches, anything. You know, it's just an excuse. You know, you have a room like this, you know, you've got to use it.
As well as Victoria and Henry and their three children, Victoria's parents also live here.
They're good, aren't they?
They are good.
Over a local kipper, Dad Michael explains how the generation game works.
So, Mike, it must be a sort of a kind of interesting sort of circular history of the house, sort of moving to one side and your daughter and her husband moving into the main part of the house.
Yeah. It's the logical progression. It's the way these things should be. My father had it handed on to him, and he handed it on to me. So I'm in the process of trying to hand it on to Victoria and Henry, who so far have been pretty good about it.
Well, you know. Oh, OK, go on then. I can imagine it is a huge responsibility.
The upkeep of an historic home like Craster costs around £25,000 a year. So to cover these high running costs, part of the house has been transformed into holiday lets.
In the old days, you had a large estate and that maintained the house. But the house has always had to wash its own face one way or another, and that's what it's doing now. Well, that's what we're trying to persuade it
to. So you're transforming it into holiday lets and family home, and that'll keep it going for another... Well, who knows?
Who knows?
Yeah. Here's to another 900 years.
Oh, thank you.
No pressure.
Something tells me the Crasters will be breaking bread in their ancient family home for many centuries to come. And visiting Craster Tower has really whetted my appetite for exploring Northumberland further. On the next leg, I meet the couple who've given a tired 1920s seafront semi a completely modern makeover.
Oh, this is a lovely kitchen, isn't it? You must have done a huge amount of work.
Huge amount, yeah.
You can really feel it.
Yeah, huge amount down here.
And I visit a new build home in a prime location right on the shore's edge.
Beautiful, isn't it? On a day like today, I'm sure it's lovely in winter, but that is just perfection, isn't it?
Get a bonus digital prepaid MasterCard up to $400 on selected kitchen appliances at Bingley.
I'm in Northumberland visiting wonderful homes along its majestic 64-mile coastline.
Up here there are miles and miles of beach. More than half the coastline is beach. And for the most part, they are stunningly beautiful and almost totally deserted. And on a very crowded island, like Great Britain, that's incredibly special.
But like many other coastal regions, the northeast does have a few classic holiday resorts as well. My next port of call is Whitley Bay, which is on the southern tip of the Northumbrian coast. There's some lovely architecture from the early 20th century here. From Art Deco cafes to the Grade 2 listed Spanish city, which was once a bustling funfair. Just 100 metres from the beach, the seafront semi I've come to see here also dates from the same era. But it's been given a contemporary update to accommodate a very modern family. It's owned by husband and wife Nick On and Nicholas Short.
So have you guys always lived by the sea?
No, not quite, but I've lived by the in Whitley Bay for the last sort of 20 years or so, and Nick's come from the city just in the last
five years. The way, 8 miles from the city down
from
to the
Newcastle.
From Newcastle. I made the brave move. It just seemed a really lovely opportunity to come and set up camp down at the coast. I think it was better for the children, really, overall.
When dad of three, Nick, met mum of one, Nicola, they needed a new home that would be big enough for their merged family. They settled on this 1920s semi-detached house and from the outside gave it a much-needed facelift. But I'm still not sure how they cram everyone in.
It's funny, isn't it? Because it doesn't look that big. I mean, it looks like a fairly standard house, but actually it is a bit bigger than normal
Demi. It's deep.
Yeah.
We call it a bit of a TARDIS.
Yeah.
But it had the right combination of rooms to suit the family.
Should we go and have a look inside?
From the moment you step through the front door, this deceptive home reveals its spacious side.
What a lovely hall.
Yeah.
God, it's really generous, isn't it? It's massive.
This was how it was when we first looked at it, and it really took us. I mean, it wasn't decorated this way, but the space and the light was fantastic for us.
Well, I think because we had the old houses, obviously they have narrow hallways.
Yeah, like that long corridor.
And because there was going to be six of us with lots of friends and people coming, a real sense of entrance.
Because what I really like is the way that this stair kind of enters and lands in the middle of the room. And then you've got these cuts and these angles as you're looking up through the building. It's very contemporary. And then you've got these massive, fantastic newel posts.
We had these made. The staircase is as it was. We had these newel posts made. We really like these.
With four growing children in the house, it's amazing how uncluttered it feels. But that's down to some good design and shrewd storage.
Storage is a big issue because there's six of us. So we got this system where we made all use. But, it's just works.
I was wondering that, because there's only four of us in our house and there just seems to be shoes everywhere.
So everybody comes in, puts the shoes away. We've got lockers in the understairs cupboard, so everybody has a locker. And you've got to have order when there's six of you in the house, so you don't have the clutter.
Off one side of the hall is this stylish lounge with bespoke fitted units and shelving. To the other is a large dining room, which flows through to the expansive contemporary kitchen that's right at the heart of this hectic family house.
Wow, this is a lovely kitchen, isn't it? You must have done a huge amount of work.
Huge amount, yeah.
You can really feel it.
Yeah, huge amount down here. Complete redesign to get what we wanted.
Well, you know, there was one of those things, what is it that you want in the house? And I just wanted a massive island, because I wanted
You certainly got a massive island.
Because it's the hub of the house, because this is where, obviously, everybody was going to meet for breakfast. And remember, we were two big houses already coming together.
We've got plenty of stuff from our past in here, our respective past, which is really important. But, you know, this is us. This is our life, our future and the kids' future. And we're sort of making it new in here. And that's been the key to this whole project for us.
Upstairs, more canny design has been employed. The couple's extended master bedroom is divided by an open stud wall that is both decorative and practical. On one side is the minimalist bedroom, complete with stylish Eames chair in the bay window.
The brief with this room was an apartment almost within the house.
Okay.
So somewhere for Nick and I just to be able to come and really chill and relax.
So you've got your own ensuite and dressing room.
Yeah, dressing room, you know, and so we're very self-contained within this room.
And it's deceptively spacious back there too. As well as the large bathroom, there's a walk-in wardrobe. And a sumptuous boudoir that's fit for a Hollywood great. And the view's a bit of a star feature as well.
The five windows, it's like a piece of abstract art sometimes. You get the sunrise in front of you, so you just get the colours, the reds, the greys, the greens of the sea. It just drags you outside.
And it just draws you into a different headspace as well, doesn't it? You know, you come home and you see that view and you can just stare at it for hours.
I think Nicola and Nick have done a great job giving their 20th century semi a contemporary update that's perfect for 21st century family life. Giving a home's interior a modern makeover is one thing. However, finding a property with contemporary exterior styling in Northumberland is a real challenge because of strict local planning policies. So if you're looking to buy a cutting-edge seaside home north of the Tyne, then you may want to head north of the border. Just 10 miles from Berwick-on-Tweed is lovely Coldingham Bay. And towering above the colourful beach huts is this superb four-bed house. With its striking wood-clad butterfly roof, the two-storey structure sits on the site of a former Edwardian pavilion and enjoys panoramic views across the North Sea through the 12-foot-high windows. With Welsh slate walls, uber-cool German kitchen, and Scandinavian suspended log burner, this home's certainly no Eurosceptic. Although, your mortgage lender might be a sceptic when they find out the price. It's £1.25 million.
Get a bonus digital prepaid MasterCard up to $400 on selected kitchen appliances at Bingley.
Back in Northumberland, my next port of call is the small village of Cresswell, overlooking gorgeous Druridge Bay. It's actually only a 40-minute drive from Newcastle-upon-Tyne, but it feels a million miles away from any city. This is a really special part of the coast, and the house I've come to see here is just up ahead, and this is a very clever little building, because from this angle, it looks quite small and diminutive, very traditional. It really fits in with its neighbours. Around the back, it's a different story. Stretching out from behind the farmhouse facade is a large, modern home. Built just 4 years ago, this sandstone-clad house sits proudly on the village's southern tip, overlooking the bay. I'm here to meet owners John and Pat McCann, who retired to their native northeast after spending years living and working in London.
Hello, John.
Hi, Charlie.
Hello, Pat.
Hi, welcome.
Pleased to meet you.
Come in. Welcome to Pan Haggerty.
Well, this is lovely, isn't it? This is a really... Ooh, look at that view. Beautiful, isn't it? On a day like today, I'm sure it's lovely in winter, but that is just perfection, isn't it?
Yes, it's only like this one day a year.
Is it?
That's hard to believe on a gentle, sunny day. You can appreciate what a special spot this home is located in.
Look, is that a fisherman popping out there?
Servicing the lobster pots, possibly. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you get lobster up here as well?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, off the rocks there.
What I love is that you can see right through the house, from kind of the land on one side and that beautiful little copse right out to the sea.
Yes.
Almost the entire ground floor of Patton John's home is open plan, with only the exposed oak frame posts delineating the different spaces.
So you wanted to create kind of a big, open, flowing kind of centre hub. Yeah.
Yes, yes, because we moved away from where our kids lived and some of our friends. So we knew that when we did get visitors, we'd probably get lots of them. And this space
and
is great.
That is what happens. We've had over 40 people in here and it doesn't feel crowded because essentially we've got four rooms without walls.
With the sun streaming in through the windows, I can imagine this would be a great venue for a summer get-together. Later, I'm going from party room to Pat and John's own ballroom, which is perfect no matter what the Northumberland weather's like.
It rotates, so that whatever the wind is, and we can have some quite stormy days here, just rotate the pod, the wind's behind you.
Sun comes in, warms it up.
It's perfect.
And how the converted boiler room of a 250-year-old farm melted the hearts of its new owners.
From the moment we walked inside of this house, you just knew it was the right house for us.
Well, I think you were sort of...
loved it from the start.
Straight away.
I'm traversing the Northumberland coast, seeking out homes with a difference in England's northernmost county. From medieval towers transformed into grand country houses, to the 20 seaside semi that's had a 21st century reboot. The latest property I've popped in on is new. A Georgian-style farmhouse in Cresswell, owned by retired management consultant John McCann and wife Pat. One thing's for sure, you'll always find them in the kitchen at parties.
Down here you've got a lovely big hot pink kitchen.
Yeah. Moroccan velvet.
That's quite a colour, I like it.
It is.
And then you've got a little day room.
Yeah, that's our sunroom where we chill and read.
Pat and John wanted a tailor-made home to fit their lifestyle, and that's precisely why they opted to build something brand new.
The idea of going through renovations and trying to get it right just seems like such hard work, whereas building a new one, starting from scratch, is particularly where we are, and you had to get it just right.
Because much of this coast is a designated area of outstanding natural beauty, there are strict planning guidelines on any new development. The couple had to incorporate traditional materials into their build and make sure the exterior design was in keeping with the local architectural style.
A lot of these old buildings don't have the same relationship to the view that you see,
or
because
the
actually they want the elements, because they just wanted to turn away from them. It's
like,
you know, I'm out all day,
and it's
working
windows.
Outside.
Yeah. I want to get away from
and
it.
And I don't want all that cold and wet coming in, so we're going to have little windows overlooking the sea. And
not taking advantage of it. That's right.
What I like about Pan Haggerty is the level of craftsmanship, especially in the carpentry. The quality is plain to see and feel.
Oh, I love the handrail.
Yeah, you must rub your hands.
Oh, this is a lovely spot. I love a big landing. I love a generous landing.
Galleried ceilings.
Yeah, hidden light sources, uplighting the oak frame. This is great. And I really like the lips that the landing and the stair make in there.
Yes.
That is not easy. You know, that is a beautiful section, and that curve, it's done a good job.
Although it's in the master bedroom, with its high vaulted ceiling and windows on every elevation,
we can see right from there, all the way down to that beautiful beach.
That you really appreciate what Pat and John have created here.
Wow, look at that view. This is just absolutely fantastic.
Even on a calm day like this, you can really get a sense of the majestic drama that is the Northumberland coastline.
Surely when you're here in the middle of winter and there's a storm with a kind of a northeasterly blowing, you must get jet washed.
Oh, we do. It comes, it hits the rocks, comes up on a high tide, then the wind catches it, throws it across the garden against the windows.
Usually and the day after the window cleans.
Yeah.
Embracing and enjoying everything nature can throw at you is part and parcel of living so close to the sea. And down in the garden is an outbuilding that guarantees a cosy spot for afternoon tea, whatever the weather.
I often see these pods, and I thought, I don't really get them. But I think living on the coast,
Yes.
I kind of get it.
Well, it's perfect here because it rotates, so that whatever the wind is, and we can have some quite stormy days here, just rotate the pod, the wind's behind you.
Sun comes cool in, warms it up.
It's perfect.
Yeah. This spot here, I think this is the most wonderful spot to have a home.
Don't tell too many people about this. We don't want to be invaded.
Well, I can see on a day like today, I can see why people would invade it. Yeah. Beautiful.
After my visit to Pat and John's place, I'm starting to realise exactly why people are drawn to this pristine part of our coastline. From the sweeping bays and wonderful wildlife, to the historic buildings that are a reminder of our nation's past. All these elements combine to make Northumberland a place people yearn to call home. For Chief Financial Officer Liz Legg, her love affair with the area began with childhood holidays in Bamburgh and is continuing thanks to her unique home inside this 250-year-old farmstead.
My links go back a long way. From being about 2 years old, I've been coming to Bamburgh pretty much every year. And as we've walked into Bamburgh, we've come past this spot. And at the time, it was quite a derelict old building. And I remember with Peter walking past one day.
Always used to say, that's going to make a fantastic development one day. And just really, then when we actually see it starting to get built, it was like, wow.
The derelict agricultural buildings were converted by a local developer in 2009 into 12 individually styled contemporary homes. The standout property being the chimney. With its 4-metre red brick smokestack, it's a property you can't fail to notice. And having coveted the building for so long, Liz and husband Peter, who works in construction, jumped at the chance to buy the chimney when it came on the market 2 years ago.
From the moment we walked inside of this house, you just knew it was the right house for us. Fell in love with it.
Then it was a no-brainer, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I think you were sort of
loved it from the start.
Straight away, yeah.
The chimney once housed the boiler room that powered the original farm. In Liz and Pete's hands, it's now a stunning 4-bedroom open-plan conversion. But there's been a real effort to retain the integrity and the soul of the original building.
It feels you are in the country, part of an old farm, because you've kept the original character of it with, obviously the chimney outside, but the archway inside. You've kept that historic feeling too. It's not just a new build. When we first bought the property, the beams were quite orangey, the walls were all magnolia, and it felt a little bit cold. And what we wanted to get was this coastal theme, but homely, so when you came in, you felt a bit more relaxed.
Combining old farmhouse with seaside chic has been one of the couple's biggest design challenges. But by carefully sourcing their fabrics and furnishings, it's a trick they've managed to pull off.
You look around the room, there's lots of driftwood and just that calming effect that we got. But we didn't want to go nautical. It was really getting the balance between beachy but a little bit more relaxed.
But it's the gorgeous scenery from the chimney that makes this such a fabulous spot to have a home.
You walk out the front door and it's a very, very impressive view to see Bamburgh Castle on your doorstep.
There's more than just a castle out there. It's about the coastal walks, the paths through the woods, the rocks. The good things about this view is it's constantly changing.
For someone with such a strong emotional tie to this area, Liz has finally been able to fulfil her childhood dream.
I'm really, really fortunate to have such a beautiful place as the chimney and such a beautiful view of Bamburgh Castle. Couldn't ask for anything more.
And on the final stage of my journey along England's northeast coast, I head to Bamburgh. There I create my very own fantasy home in the shadow of its imposing castle.
Up here would just be my dream spot to put a house.
Before heading inside this iconic Northumberland landmark to meet the couple who were lucky enough to call it home.
We would have been kind of having 22 course meals, and that's they would have been bringing roast oxen down that passageway.
That's one of the big dogs lolling around there.
Get a bonus digital prepaid MasterCard up to $400 on selected kitchen appliances at Bingley.
I'm on the final leg of my journey along the coastal limits of northern England. And the ancient landscape of Northumberland has thrown up some surprises. From the TARDIS-like semi with its deceivingly spacious interior, to the country mansion that's actually three historic homes rolled into one. And it's this inescapable sense of history that surrounds you in Northumberland that's inspired my idea for a fantasy home I'd love to build here if I could.
If I was going to build a house up in Northumberland, I think it'd be hard-pressed to get a better spot than this. Partly because that's a really good surf beach and I love to surf. Partly because over in the distance there you've got the beautiful silhouette of Bamburgh Castle and that is just so beautiful. And so I think up here on this sort of bluff would just be the most phenomenal place for a house. And I don't think you can build a piece of modern architecture in this part of the country without sort of looking towards the fortified ruins and the castles that dominate the landscape. So I think that would be my sort of starting point. I would look to build kind of really solid, fairly squat, very strong tower.
The circular walls would be built from gorgeous local sandstone with large slot windows to allow in light. And instead of battlements on top, I'd have a rooftop master bedroom with glass walls to fully appreciate the spectacular scenery.
And I think next to that, I would just put a very simple flat line. I think one of the things that I really love, beaches, which just go on forever, these lovely flat lines.
This single story would also be made of glass and extend out from the tower's base. In here would be the home's main living room. And to soften its shape amongst the dunes, I'd give it a living roof using the wild grasses that grow along this shoreline.
Your views just from the dining table out across the beach. Up here. I don't know, man, I think that'd be hard to beat. That'd be hard to beat.
My fantasy home's a modern interpretation of this area's architectural heritage, and one that wouldn't impose too much on this beautiful shoreline. But it's to Northumberland's most iconic landmark that I'm heading to next on the final stop of my trip. Rising 150 feet from a rocky whinstone outcrop, the imperious Bamburgh Castle has towered above this coastline for almost 1,000 years. And after admiring it from afar, I'm keen to get a closer look and meet the Englishman whose home really is a castle. Chris Calvert isn't a king or an earl, but he and his Italian wife Grazia have lived and worked in this incredible building since 2007.
Hello, Chris. Hello, Grazia. Very nice to meet you. So how do you end up living in a castle, unless you're lord of the castle?
Because you become employed by somebody who owns a castle.
OK. So how does it work? You live here and,
we do.
And you have to sort of run the show, is that right?
Yeah, very, very much that.
This beautiful sandstone building looks every inch the mighty citadel it once was. And people have called this imposing place home since Roman times. But its current form owes much to the Victorian industrialist and inventor, Lord William Armstrong, who restored the castle to the magnificent structure it is today. His ancestor, Francis Watson Armstrong, is the present owner, although he leaves Chris and Grazia to welcome Bamburgh's 100,000-plus visitors a year.
You cannot take this for granted because we won't be here forever. So whatever time you spend here, we will enjoy it and do our best to make this place run and it's supposed to, as it deserves to.
Well, clearly it's stunning from the outside. Can we have a look around inside?
Yeah, sure, come on.
First stop on my personal guided tour is the spectacular Great Hall. This grand room would have been the beating heart of castle life, where kings held court and sumptuous banquets were served. Surprisingly, though, this fantastic space doesn't date back to the Middle Ages, but the relatively recent 19th century.
This hall actually sits on the same floor plan as the medieval Great Hall that was here before it.
This is an incredible roof, isn't it?
It's fascinating, isn't it? It's a false hammer beam ceiling made from 300 tonnes of Siamese teak, and it was all manufactured up here in the northeast. And directly opposite us here is the start of a passageway that ran from here down to the great kitchens, which are a few rooms beyond
us.
So
we would have been kind of having 22-course meals, and they would have been bringing roast oxen down that passageway.
That's one of the big dogs lolling around, yeah.
This sprawling fortress covers 9 acres and is one of the largest inhabited castles in Britain. The 70-foot-high keep is the oldest surviving section, and was constructed in the mid-12th century using locally quarried stone.
So here we're in the Norman keep.
So this is, what, 1100?
This specific one was built in the early 1100s, yes.
So this stonework has been here for nearly 1,000 years.
Yeah.
It's kind of incredible, isn't it?
It's mind-blowing to think people have lived here for so long. But the wise Normans knew this would make a safe and secure place to build a permanent residence.
The reason they built the keep here on this spot was because the Anglo-Saxons had sunk a well here.
So we're on top of a massive mound right next to the sea.
Yeah, so it's 135 feet deep. It gets better here because the stone that they went through was a dolerite, was really, really, really hard, really dense. They call it windstone because when you whack it with a hammer,
yes.
It rings.
So this is 135 foot through windstone?
Half of it is, yeah.
How do they do that?
It is very susceptible to heating and contraction, expansion, contraction. So they reckon that they would light a big fire, get it really, really hot, whip the fire off and then chuck cold water on it.
For 135 foot.
And get it to crack.
That's stubbornness, isn't it?
For all its sturdiness, living in a damp stone keep couldn't have been much fun. Fortunately for Chris and Grazia, Bamburgh's accommodation has improved somewhat over the last millennium.
So here we go from castle to home.
Where once castle staff would have been downstairs, now employees are very much upstairs in this bright apartment.
I mean, this could be a sort of a flat in any building in England.
Almost.
And you're in a castle.
Yeah.
And it's only when you look out the window that you kind of go, wait a second. You know, I was expecting kind of big open fires and, you know, kind of rush on the floor and huge tables roasting pigs. It's not like that at all, is it?
No, Chris is vegetarian.
At a certain time, everyone leaves and it's just Just you in the castle.
Yeah, that in a way, it's nice when that happens. It's, you know, 5 o'clock and it just goes very, very quiet out there, very peaceful, very still. So it's nice to take a beer down to the Battery Terrace and sit on the Battery Terrace and enjoy a beer in the sunshine.
But the view I really want to see is from the ramparts above Chris and Grazia's modern home. And it's from this elevated position you can really appreciate the landscape that this regal building sits in.
I mean, this beach is mind-blowing, isn't it?
Absolutely, yeah. I actually enjoy it every morning.
But how do you... You're from Italy, right? This is cold. This is the North Sea. How do you put up with it in winter?
You adapt yourself.
You swim in it, don't you?
I do, yeah.
In a wetsuit?
No.
Whoa. You're braver than I am. Have you kind of grown very attached to Northumberland and this part of the coast?
We've been very privileged. We've lived in some fantastic places. Iona on the west coast of Scotland. We've lived in Martinique. We've lived in Corsica in the south of France. But everything comes together here. Look at the scenery around you, look at the beach, and then look at the building that we're so privileged to live in.
Visiting Bamburgh Castle marks a fitting end to my Northumberland odyssey. It may have been my first time here, but it will definitely not be my last. And as well as its natural beauty, this craggy, unspoilt coastline has some cracking homes too, both ancient and modern.
Considering this stretch of coast is just a few hours from some of the UK's most important cities, it is remarkably unspoiled, and it is alive with history. The houses I've visited in the last few days tell the story of this country for over 1,000 years. The history, the landscape, the beaches, it is all epic.
Next time, I'm looking back over my summer of travelling around the beautiful British coastline, where I met some fantastic people and most of all saw some incredible homes by the sea.